these bitches, dog, I'm stacking. Stacking. Fuck these niggas, dog, I'm stacking. I'm stacking. Fuck the club, cause I'm stacking. Fuck the club. Call the plug, tell them, dog, we need expansion. I remember when I got my mind made. That I'ma be full time in this dope game. Yo. I wasn't satisfied with prizes and small dollars. Yo. Had too many coupe dreams for me and all my partners. Fortune 500, mine stay, but in the streets, though. The streets. I was just broke about a week ago. Yeah. Now I'm smirking at my stash when I see it.
Cook that shit up, Quay.
Baby. Four pockets. That is my dog. Yeah. That is my dog, show. That is my dog. That is my dog, show. That is my dog. Me and my dog. We get 'em two in a row. Me and my dog, we get them two in a row. That she keep on calling. She said she ready to pull up. As soon as I get there, I'ma put her on the floor nails. I'm on my way, I'm going fast. I'm coming home to get you. I'm on my way, I'm going fast. I'm coming home to get you. $100,000 on my neck. Another $50,000 on my wrist. Every nigga with me real rich. Niggas having pressure by the bitch. I got all my cases dismissed.
How to Stack Your Money, the documentary. Get your money, quit acting funny. What is this? What is this, man? Well, really, it's a way of living. It's a way of being. It's a way of thinking. It's all sparked through me seeing boarded up houses, abandoned houses, blocks and blocks, doors, blighted neighborhoods. And I was like, man, how do I solve that problem? How do I change that? So I got determined. I got dedicated. Yeah, I was willing to sacrifice in order to achieve this goal, in order to change neighborhoods, to change what I saw. You know, I just and this documentary is really here just to paint a small picture, give you a window into that insight, hopefully motivate and inspire you to stay true to yourself and your vision. But before you usually can see your vision through. And you got to get your money right, man. You got to get your mind right. You got to get your personal finances together. You got to be able to manage yourself. And that's where it all started. It all started for me before I could buy that first rental property. It took a year. It took 18 months, over a year for me to get my personal finances right so I could execute and do that. So, man, get your money. Quit acting funny, man. See it through, man. Follow your mission. Follow your dreams, man. Stay true to your vision. Stack your money, man, and stay out the way, man. Thelonious C. Jones, thank you. Get your money. Quit acting funny.
Tell them where we at, Bob. We in the West Side, man. The real West Side. The real West Side.
Man, cause this is where I started at, man. And these people in here, great people. And it's a great lot, man. Great area. But this is how I started, man. I saved up enough money on this lot to go out and get my truck driver's license. And then I bought my own fucking house like a year later.
How long were you here?
I was here about 9 months. Once I found this place, I told Alex to keep me here. I was like, Alex, bro, you got to keep me here. That's my cousin through marriage. I was like, bro, you got to keep me here. And I stayed here, and I got to know the people, the people inside, and it was good. Yeah. I got to know all the regulars, so it was like a regular thing. And you know how it is. Once you get that regular flow, they tip you. You know what I mean?
Yeah. How long you been here?
About 2.5 years now.
He
got more expense.
He's like, you only made 500? He said, you only made 500?
He's looking at me like this. What is this guy doing?
I'm pretty much just following your footsteps, bro. One time, I'd be like, just like you.
We are out here, bro. We all like each other, man.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's the way to go, brother. That's the way to go.
What was one of the biggest lessons you learned, though, working here? Because you know how you say in the book, you gotta have some income if you're trying to stack. So you had the goal to get the CDLs, right? To get the, yeah. So you got this as income flow to stack to that goal.
So I could transition to go get the CDLs.
Right. What's one of the biggest lessons?
I mean, you gotta stay out there pretty much. That's what it meant. That's what I learned.
Yeah.
Rain, sleet, snow. I've been through a tornado. Like I was telling you, in this parking lot, everything. So. Sometimes you gotta stand out in the rain to get the shit done.
Mm.
Stand out, whatever it takes. So,
you gotta weather the storm to get what you want done.
Like you see, it was raining today one minute, it's not raining, you know what I mean? And you can't come back, hey man, I'm a valet, I need to come inside and chill. No. You're out, dude.
Yeah.
You just gotta make it work, man.
Yeah.
Make it work.
Yep. See, hanging with the cold
killers, I ain't never backed down or ran from no nigga. I ain't sat down yet, here I stand to go gorilla. Even if I'm all alone, I stand at four niggas. Tell them jump, dipping, they don't get no realer. 5'9 with the soul of a 6'4 nigga. I separated the fakes, paralyzed from the waist down. From the real stand up guys of the A-Town. Can't even look me in my eyes, put your face down. I'm out of jail, nigga, what you gotta say now?
So we over here at the FedEx. This is where you used to work.
2008. This is really where it all started because right here, I used to come out that door right there, and this guy would always be pulled up in front there with his tractor trailer in the morning. I worked from 3 a.m. to 8 a.m. So he used to be parked right there, and he always be walking like this with a big smile on his face, and I always just gesture and wave to him. And then one day I went out there and I'm just like, hey bro, let me holler at you, bro. I said, how much money you make, man? And he was like, I make like $2,200 to $2,500 a week. And I just like looked at him because I'm like making $250 a week, mind you, working here every night, 5 days a week. And I'm just like, man, that's why he's so happy. That's why he's smiling like that. And after that conversation, it only took me about 5 months to get my license. After I had that conversation, I went and got my CDL. So the whole journey of stacking, yeah, I was stacking my money while I was working here, but once I got my CDL, that one conversation can really change your life. That one conversation I had with Al, fast shout out to you, Al, wherever you at, fast shout out to my supervisor, David Cooper, because they was real easy with me transitioning out, James King, everybody here, man, my boy Orlando, everybody I worked here with, but that one conversation is what catapulted me to go out and get my license, man, get on that road. And then I got my property, you know, within about, I would say about two and a half years of that initial conversation right out here. So fast shout out to y'all, thank you, man, you know what I mean, for that advice, and that put me on a whole nother level.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, because at 23 years old, most 23-year-olds, what are we doing? I mean, really, honestly, we just want to hang out. We just want to drink. We just want to go party, go clubbing, spend our money, you know, unwisely. Yeah. And just, you know, throw up in the toilet bowl the next day. That's it. So, I mean, how do you separate, or how did you separate the evils of being a 23-year-old or the beauty of being a 23-year-old and real estate investing?
I was, for lack of a better word, I was almost locked up. I was in a truck. What happened to me was I got my truck driving license in the summer of 2008. I got my license, my commercial driver's license. I was driving through the Midwest, I think around September of 08. I ran into this brother at a shipping yard. I think it was in Illinois, somewhere in the Midwest. I remember that. And I write about this in my free ebook that you can get at theloniacjones.com. I ran into him and we were talking, and he was like, bro, I don't have no apartment. I got rid of everything. I sleep out in my truck and I just stay with my girl when I go back home. And I thought to myself, this dude done lost his damn mind. Like, what the hell is this dude talking about? He live out the damn truck. And then I left there and I stepped going over the numbers in my mind. And I was like, dude, I'm the only motherfucker crazy in this equation. I'm the only person crazy. I'm judging him. But when I started doing the numbers, I was like, 2 months later, I got rid of the. Hey, man, I ain't re-signing no lease or nothing. Keep it. And that was it, man. I went and slept out of truck. So from there, like there was no way for me to be distracted. While people were in the club Saturday night, I'm at the damn truck stop in the back of a truck, chilling. Getting ready for the next day.
Spent a lot of bread, wish I saved every penny. Love a lie, don't know about the Trinity. You think I lie, ain't one of you my enemy. Blast, ask questions late, like the wave with the gay and the navigator. Say, man, we loose alligators through a jungle. We're coming through a gun ho. Smile through the spot, drop, rock, slang, bang. Fire on, dust the dawn. Keep on with the stats, boogie the ski, man.
You know, how did you really get started in real estate, Theo?
Okay, my pops, like I told y'all, even though I'm dealing with a lot of shit with my pops, and I'm gonna come out with a whole book around this, because I feel at times, I don't even want to get on, that's going to get too deep. But the way I got in was, my great-grandfather, my father's grandfather, he built a house in Richmond, California,
right off the freeway where all like all the white folks live. So he was in construction and development. So my father saw that a lot growing up through his grandfather. My father bought his own building. I would say probably when I was about 10 or 11 in downtown Oakland. And he bought it for like $250, and he just sold that bitch for like a $1.5 million last year. But grew up going there and working a lot, sweeping, cleaning, doing all that, and that kind of was like the beginning, you know, for me. So that gave me the window into it. And then I have a lot of people in my family that's involved in real estate, and not to the extent I want to be involved in it, but at least they were in it, and you know, the conversation was always around me. You know what I mean?
So you brought me to the first.
This is okay. This house right here, first house I ever purchased, $5,000 down.
Uh huh.
A couple months later, the government gave me shit. What did they give me? $8,000 tax credit. I lived in one side for 4 years. So one side was rented out with me in there. I was paying, you know, just in there. Then the other side was rented to, I had a tenant in there for 4 years. And then after the 4 years, I moved out, put two new tenants in there, and they were paying $875 a piece on each side. So I was making $1,750, and my note was like $700 a month. So it was a positive $1,000 a month. Bought it for $5,000 down, a $75,000 purchase price, and I sold it for $150,000, but I would have sold it for $165,000, but the appraisal came back real low.
Was it because
of this area?
So
a lot of people don't understand the area, and there's not a lot of brand new. See, this is the only real use. All these houses are built. These are all 30s houses, 40s houses here, 30s and 40s. So when you got these houses here built in 2003, it's not a lot of duplexes, so it kind of throws the dynamic off.
So why'd you want to invest in this area that's not really up and coming? It's I just saw a lot of boarded up houses.
Because I know at times this area is going to change, and that's what's happening now. It's changing, and it just takes time.
Did you see that vision?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
I've seen this for years, and it's happening now. When we hit them a couple more of these blocks, you'll see a lot more of them building. It's just this area right here is just a little rough. When we go out a couple more blocks, you'll see it. But
okay.
It's changing.
So, and it's just moving. So, but you sold the house, so I mean, you don't own it anymore. Where'd you get the $5,000?
Saved up. Truck driving,
right?
Saved up my money and bought this. This was my first house, and made a killing off of it, if you ask me.
Yeah, no, that's a good flip. That's what they. But you sat in there for some time, so.
Yeah, I made over $75,000 in rental income, gross rental income, over that 6 years holding the property.
Wow.
Yeah. So,
wow.
And you know, great investment.
Yeah.
Somebody hit me the other day for a rendezvous. Was it the Winch that cut the good and the dungeon crew? Let's say her name was Susie Screw, cause she screwed a lot. Making a player hit that chunk at legitimate spots. Not no parks, bat seats, and things of that nature. Had to hate your player. I'm kicking the door down, never said I hate her. Straight later, played the girl like Darth Vader. Made her from Collie Park and Fed, all the way down to Decatur. Like Jada, her wig was sharp and sporty, that was shouty. Save with the snake on eggs and a Beamer 840. It's foggy. I went to the crib to call her, but she lost me. My baby mama beat me, 7 o'clock is gonna cost me. But I still wanna cut her though, maybe she had to work. I called her in the mall, wearing a real tight skirt. She was fine as what? I wanted to say.
You were his neighbor?
Yeah.
When he had this?
Yeah.
This?
I sure was.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Tell me about him.
Well, one thing about it, his a very hardworking man. Him and his dad, very hardworking. Truck crank up like clockwork every time, every morning the same time. One of the things that I like about Theo is the fact that he was always about the neighborhood. He would always talk about the different abandoned homes and how people in the community and even some of the people that are famous need to get together to get, you know, the community back and not let, you know, people come in and take the community from us. So, I mean, and I just really think that just him being in the neighborhood, the presence that he have, the neighborhood has changed. A lot of the houses around here used to be abandoned.
I flipped a Lexi, speed up and catch me. Lexus of Concord, reached out and touched me. Some of you whole kick ass niggas like bras be messy. I know some beautiful black intelligent women that's sexy. E40 back, acting black. I don't be barking, no even high capping. You better watch me, I'm coming snapping.
I used to own a house right here just a block away. Not even a block away. We're a couple steps away. We'll go over there in a second. This whole neighborhood, and it wasn't... It was so many... I mean, even you can see, Stace, in the year and a half that you were here, it just completely changed, man. So imagine it almost 10 years ago where it was at. It was just, it was like almost like a war zone, you know, almost like it had been bombed by, like, bad mortgages. Like, somebody just dropped a bomb of bad mortgages, like a nuclear bomb, and, like, it exploded all in this neighborhood, you know what I mean? And everything was just vacant. Now it's just completely turned, man, and I seen this. This was my vision. Shit, man. Even before I bought the house in 2009, I knew this shit was gonna change. We'll go over to Pittsburgh and right around there, but yeah, man, I've been seeing, and there's very few houses like this. Like, this is still one that's a dilapidated, but you know, it's still rehabable, man, and somebody gonna come in here and fix this, man. So it's just having that vision, knowing, hey, man, this is a prime area. You see the streets now, how they all paved. They got the new concrete pads for the wheelchair. None of that shit was here. None of that shit was here when I came. But when you had a vision, it all comes, man. It's just a matter of time, man. So we here. This is, we in Northwest Atlanta, Vine City to be exact. You know, the hood, AKA the hood. This property right here was owned by Elder Gentleman. He owned four other small apartments. One is just right around the corner. We just looked at it. So this is one of four he owned. This was the only one that was not occupied. The other ones had tenants in it. I tried to buy all four of the properties from him, but he wouldn't come up with the leases, and I got tired of going back and forth with him. And actually, we were in a 1031 exchange, so we were trying to get this done swiftly. If you don't know what a 1031 exchange is, do some homework. And basically, this was the only one that wasn't occupied, so I just said, hey, man, I give you $35,000 for this six-unit apartment, man. Cash, just walk away from it. I'll deal with all the back taxes and whatever. You can see up here, it's pretty burnt. You know what I mean? I'll deal with all of that. So basically, gave him $35,000 cash for the property. Got it closed out. Did that transaction in September of 2015. And then 4 months later, in January of 2016 of this year, we sold this property for $85,000. Obviously, we didn't fix it.
146 Graves. Bought it for, I think, 30-something thousand. Sold it for like $80-something thousand. Didn't it do a single repair to this thing, man.
I guess that's what you call buy and hold.
Yeah, a couple months.
Buy and hold.
Yeah,
you ain't buy and do nothing to it. You just held it.
And just
looked at it.
And
remarked it.
Showed them, hey,
the vision.
The opportunity.
And this is what they saw.
And the other buyer, unfortunately, just wasn't able to. I mean, the other owner, but previous to me, wasn't able to display that. So, unfortunately, he couldn't do it. If they gonna do something, I'm glad the roof. I ain't even noticed that the roof was done. That's real good to see.
Four founders smoking pounds of straight crime. This West Conference bomb shit. I got that from around them. Backyard smoking large while we charge them low riders. Later on, we clowning. I'm really out here and you not about it. Where was you? You was not around here. Huh? Say you was, but you really lying. I'm riding. You hibernating, your bitches are hiding. Something. Yeah. Stack it till we got nowhere to put it.
So gentrification, you got bikers, you got runners out here running with their babies. You're seeing it. So you saw something that a lot of investors didn't see in this area. Where are we currently?
We are currently on Ralph David Abernathy in the West End, a historic area in Atlanta. Actually, this neighborhood was voted Neighborhood of the Year last year, and I'm about to take you to a house. This property we're about to pull up on, I bought it from a real estate fund out of Denver. I bought this house and five other houses for $15,000 a piece. This house, we put about $28,000 into it. We have a tenant that stayed in there for 3 years paying $850, and we sold this property for $62,000. So mind you, we paid $15,000, okay?
Yep.
Plus the 28 to fix it.
Okay.
Then eight times 10 is $8,000 a year. So 8,000 times 3 is $21,000. This is the house right here. So we recall. collected obviously about 20, over 20 grand in rent, and we sold the house for $62,000. And actually, the guy that owns that, bought this house from us, actually owns a house on this block. So it was a, like I said, win-win. And I'm about creating win-win situations for everybody. So he was able to buy this house on this block. Now he has two houses. He got cash flowing property. He's making money, and life is great. You know what I mean? So that's basically.
So you're really a solution. It's helping people.
Trying to help people.
Get on that springboard, whether it's a place to live and grow a family, or you know something
an
that
investment,
an investment,
purchase,
they're trying to purchase.
Or like the guy we did the seller financing, giving him an opportunity to have seller finance and buy a house for $5,000 down. So it's just, for me, it's really about how do I come up with solutions every day for everybody, and you know, and that's what I want to be remembered as. Who wants to be remembered as someone that didn't come up with a solution? You know what I mean? It's just like stupid, kind of.
So I mean, you're about legacy then, you know, because you drove you drove down a bunch of blocks, and it's like, yeah, this is my first. I seen the first one on a block that was the dead zone.
I mean,
that block had more boarded up houses. That thing looked than anything, right?
Yeah.
So you saw potential in there before someone else. You lived in the home, you know, for 4 years.
Yeah, four years,
and then that was your first property. You started with $5,000. How does someone start, man? How does someone?
For me, I think they need to start by stacking up their money. You got to stack up your money, and you got to get your money straight. For me, I'm just not into the no money down thing.
So, 2014, acquired this for $40,000. Sold it for $380,000. 2017. Did a lot of value add here. It looks like the new owner has done some value add too, but we get all new windows, gutters, septic, fascia, everything. I come up here, we submeter.
This all porcelain tile. This ain't that cheap ceramic crap.
Yeah.
I mean, come on, man. This $1.79 per tile. I can go get some 50-cent tile easily, but hey, I want it to last forever. This tile, I'll never have to rehab this place again.
We're good.
So it's just about, for me, just doing it once and being done. Might fuck around, see me on the post. When I leave, I'ma do the top speed on it. F on the rim, can you read, homie? You can tell the Gucci from the sleeve, homie. You can tell the Gucci from the sleeve, homie. Young nigga, ball, fuck, live. Yo, nigga, feel me? Young nigga, ball, fuck, live. Yo, life. Young nigga, ball, fuck, live. Yo, nigga, I can't young nigga, ball, fuck, live. Yo, life. Young nigga, ball, fuck, live.
In your steps, like boy, from when you and Pops was doing y'all thing,
when you came down
with the flippings,
yeah.
Y'all was flipping something tough, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I seen the progression where you had to expand and do something more than just the houses. You wanted bigger stuff.
You was telling
me about them apartment buildings and stuff, the units.
Yeah.
I need 100 units. I don't need no one.
So that was
a big step for you, like.
Yeah.
Because I know you said you read the bullets. What did you personally get out of how to stack your money?
Me personally, I would say common sense. You can't save if you don't have a stable income. You know, if you always going broke or having financial problems, you're going to have to keep reaching into that.
And for one, I didn't even know. I remember you had told me in the past you were trying to put some money on the book, but I didn't even know that it came to fruition. So to see that it did, because I found out about it by being a finished product.
Yeah.
It was a finished product. It wasn't like, some people keep talking. It was like, damn. This,
I like that.
It was a viable thing you put in somebody's hands. So I was like, damn, this dude did this. You know? And I'm like, this is the first time I ever had somebody that's young write a book and give it to, you know, and it may, you know, and then on top of that too, just even be on that page.
That book is real simple, like it's to the point. It ain't no sugarcoat, nothing. It gets straight to the issue on how to get your money and stack it. That's what I like about it. Ain't no big old 300-page book, none of that. It gets straight to the point. You can read it over and over and over again and just input it inside of you.
But if you start off, let's say, making $12, $13 an hour, you know, some people probably can't get that. We'll say 10. If you can get $10 an hour, you make maybe a $600 check. Make a set price, don't change it. $100 a check. $100 ain't gonna kill you. Because believe it or not, when you go buy snacks, you go buy etc., you spend $100.
Yeah.
When really you could have saved that to where when you broke, you're not broke. And it kind of gives you that, it gives you a little more background of feeling like, oh, I mean, I don't have any money in my pocket, but in my bank account, I have $600.
You good.
You know, yeah, it's just like, once you get the concept of saving, that's how we're going to get it. You know, I'm not going to speak as in race term, but I would just say black people, our race, that's the problem we got. Everybody, oh, spend it, we can get it back. Spend it, we're going to get it back. You know, most of, like, I would not even just say celebrities and rappers, just people that actually have good income. They feel like, oh, I can spend this because I know next paycheck, I got this coming back.
Yeah.
Budgeting. Very, very, very important.
That book is amazing. It really tells you about how to be intentional. Not just everyone saves, but why are you saving?
Mm.
If you ain't got nothing to invest in or put it in, then it ain't no point of stacking. You got to have your goals down and what you're trying to do. Be intentional. Make sure your bills ratio to your gross, your
net pay.
make sure it's right. You know, get in that power stack lane, man. 50%.
But it's like a lot of this stuff be like, it's simple, but it's like things that most people do not really think about, like on a daily basis. Why do you even think about that? So it's just like, it only kind of bring like certain things to your attention that you may not have probably been taught when you was growing up or something like that.
Yeah.
It just kind of just bring it to your attention and you're aware of it. And that way you can, well, all right, I need to change this. That small change will make a big difference in your life.
Cash, tunnel vision to the bag. Riches come from the rags. It's survival of the fittest. Make a nigga strip for everything he had. Kill a nigga, be killed. Baby, it's you or me. You the type I eat for breakfast. Nigga, born number 10. I demolish every beat. Really ain't no competition. But talent really don't mean a motherfucking thing. Don't nobody listen. Be that as it may. No one said to the guap. At the end of the day, I'll accept nothing less than the top. Don't even want to hear your name. If they all know the netto. Fresh Prince, nigga, Teardrop, Dollar, Raphael, Delegato. Always stand on my lane. To the flow with the pedal. Baby, choosing one to pair. Nigga, make a burn rubber since the letters. Lead to the money. Right hand to God. You know what I can do. Baby, I'ma need it all. Middle finger to the lows. Bread busting on my draws. Hell race to the snow. When the spring, summer fall. Pleasure leading to the money. Nigga, right hand to God. You know what I can to do. Baby, I'ma need it all. Middle finger to the lows. Money busting on my draws. Hell race to the snow. When the spring, summer fall. Keep it focused on the team. Never triple, get it more than them. Tell my slime I got it covered. Old school nigga loaded it. I cut off a nigga legs if it's standing in the way. I cut off a nigga head for the combination of the same.